Shalom, shalom, shalom. Once again, you're not under the sounds of the voice of your brother Tazadok. Dark. We're coming at you through the spirit of Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shah. And so we begin all things with the name of Yahweh, Yahweh Shah. And so I wanted to talk, I guess I got to put my disclaimer out first. I wanted to talk to you about the structures of courts, federal courts and civil court. And I wanted to talk to you about the rules and procedures for filing a case in a district court. Now, I want to say this is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, you can self-competent counsel. And then please be advised, everything I'm about to give you strictly for educational, informational, entertainment purposes only, is never to be misconstrued or taken as legal advice. Already been validated. You already know what it is. I just want to say shalom, Yahya Bay, Jimmy Alicia. Y'all need that Mustang. Oh, yo, by the way, let me put this out here, man. Jimmy Alicia got himself a nice convertible Mustang. You know what I mean? And he lives next door to a guy that has a 56 Chevy. So I'm going to take that 56 Chevy and run into your new Mustang so you don't have to drive that truck again. So we can't really mess with him anymore about the Fred Sanford truck. He got a souped out Mustang. But anyways, to those of you that do not know Jimmy Alicia, you'll probably see him in NY in the Bronx driving in a blue Mustang. Anybody see him driving in that blue Mustang, just run into him so his insurance will go up or what have you. But anyways, so I want to say this. So I'm thinking of doing another seminar, trying to decide whether to do it in Dallas, Texas, or maybe Cleveland, Ohio. I've never been to Cleveland, Ohio, or maybe even in Atlanta again. Or if there's someone interested in South Carolina, let me know. I'm even trying to go there. I really don't want to go to North Carolina. Some people there I don't really want to deal with, but that's another story. So again, this is not legal advice. And so let me know in the room. You can put your comments in the room, like where you want a seminar, either Dallas, Texas, like somewhere in Ohio, it could be Cleveland, whatever, if enough people get together, or maybe somewhere in South Carolina. Like, let me know. I'm trying to get that done within the next 2 weeks before, you know, school and all that starts again and I get excessively busy. So now, you know, that I educated you the night of last night, you know, I talked to you about the procedures, the five elements of filing a lawsuit. So this evening, through the spirit of Yahweh Bahasham, Yahweh Shah, I wanted to talk to you about some very important information before filing the case in federal court that you need to know. Before filing the case anyways, you're going to have to determine whether or not the court has jurisdiction. Even if you're suing someone, you need to be able to determine whether or not the court has jurisdiction. And jurisdiction, again, is authority given to a court to hear and decide a particular case. So the United States Supreme Court is given its authority by Article 3 in the Constitution of the Federal Republic. So all other courts either has to have a delegation of authority order from the Supreme Court, which is actually in Washington, D.C., or they could actually get that from Congress. If they don't have it in court, in writing, then that means they don't have it, brother, sister, for educational purposes only. And if they don't have it, are you obligated to be there? That's a rhetorical question. If there's no delegation of authority order, then under what order am I to be in this court? And how do you actually have jurisdiction over me? Those are some questions that I often ask. So before I start, I want to say this because I think some people need this right here. So some of you, you're going, I was talking to a brother today, he's going through it. A lot of you out there, you're going through struggles. And it's like, you know, exceedingly difficult for you. Things may not be going so well, might be like real hard on you, and so on and so forth. And you feel like life is just kicking you in the rear end. And you're like ready to give up. Some of you, you're actually having problems in your marriages. Some of you, you have an issue with narcotics. Many of you have a problem with marijuana. You just can't leave it alone. You swear marijuana is not addicting, but you can't stop. You can't stop using it. Have a problem eating bad food. You sit on the damn couch all day. You're watching a damn Xbox, Netflix marathon. And you're sitting there, you're eating pizza, and you're drinking sodas, and, you know, you're eating popcorn, you know, flooded with butter, and you're fat, but you're doing this. And you're telling yourself, yeah, I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to stop doing this. And you're eating on intimate. You're eating things that you really shouldn't be eating. And then you get this big damn thing of ice cream, and you just go in and say, I'm just going to have a cup. And you go to the freezer, and you keep eating more and more ice cream. And because of the way that they're designing foods now, you can't stop eating it. So you start eating, and you look down in the container, and you ate the damn, almost the whole damn half a gallon of ice cream. And then when you finish eating it, you're fat. And you're already fat. You're fat. You look at yourself, you're fat, and you acknowledge that you're fat. But you're trying to get a trainer. You're trying to do whatever it takes to try and lose the weight, except for the correct thing, which is to stop your bad habit of eating bad food. You're fat, but you won't admit it. You won't turn around and look in the mirror and say, the only way that I'm going to change is right now. You talk about what you're going to do tomorrow. Tomorrow is not a reality. Tomorrow is a nice dream, but it's not a reality. You know, there's someone that, you know, very special to me. She would always say, I'm still warming up to you. I'm working on it. And I would like often say, it's like, well, the only reality that we have is like right now. That's the only reality. So, and I'm saying this so that you can learn that planning for tomorrow, you're going to end up with a lot of empty yesterdays, because your tomorrow is essentially determined by what you do right now. The wise man turns around, he's doing an about face, and he look in the freaking mirror and say, damn. My tomorrow is right now. It's determined by what I do right now. You got to turn around and look yourself in the face and say, if I don't do it now, it's likely not to happen. So don't wait for tomorrow to tell that person that you love them. Don't wait for tomorrow to stop eating the bad food. Do it now. Stop doing all these bad habits that you got. You got to stop doing it now. You got to turn around, look in the mirror and say, the only reality is right now, not tomorrow. Yesterday is done. Yesterday is not a reality either. You got to stop going back to yesterday. The only time that we should resort to going to yesterday is if we're going back to get something positive. Because if you're going to look into yesterday to bring up something that's toxic, then you're just damaging yourself. Your only reality is right now. And you're talking to someone that made it from the bottom. Like, I came from the slums. I've been through the slums. I lived in the ghettos. And I didn't make it out because of luck, because there's a lot of people that's still there. Luck, what you call it luck, is really hard work. It's perseverance. It's dedication. It's falling down and getting back up. I work. If I'm weak in a particular area, it won't be for long. Not with me. And you got all of the damn haters and naysayers that come around. Oh, yeah, Tazadah, he's this, he's that, so on and so forth. You got people, you got trolls that come around putting bad things about me in videos. What have I done? The only thing that I've done is try to educate you and give you right knowledge. It may have hurt your feelings sometimes by the way that I present it, because you're a fat ass and you're fat and I call you fat. So it cuts you. It makes you feel bad. But the only time you're really going to change if something emotional touched you. It has to be something that's heartfelt. And so I tell you to look at your fat ass in the mirror, and you're fat. You don't want to admit it. You say, oh, no, I'm just big bone. Well, that's baby fat. How in the hell is that baby fat? You're grown. It's not baby fat. You're fat. You're fat. Just say I'm fat. I'm a fat son of a gun, and I'm going to change this. I mean, so because you could be fat, but it doesn't have to stay that way, because your life is not over. You have the capacity to change. You understand what I'm saying? You fat bastard. Now stop eating the damn pizza. Stop eating the sodas and all of that, because you're making yourself worse. The reason you're depressed is because you didn't fix this. A lot of people go to the gym and they're George-apping all the damn time in the gym, just talking, running off at the mouth. But your training really starts here. Because if you're not properly trained here, you could go to the gym all you want to. You're going to go right back to your bad eating and all of that. So the first thing you got to train is your mind. It's the same thing in anything, whether you're trying to be successful in life, whether you're trying to be successful on a job, whether you're trying to be successful in your marriage. You're trying to make a relationship work. It starts right here. It starts changing you. People are always pointing the finger. Oh, you did this. You said this to me. Well, if you point a finger at me, you better check your fucking hand and make sure it's not dirty, because you got three fingers pointing right back at you each time that you point a finger at me. Understand that. So the first thing that we have to learn to do is to fix ourselves. Stop blaming others. Because you could take, watch this. You could take a person that think that they're righteous, right? They're going to get a new car. They're going to get a new home. Yeah, got a new home. That's great. Hey, I'm living like the Joneses. Got a new home. Got a new car. Your relationship with having a little bit of problems, instead of talking it out, instead of looking at you and say, what's fucked up about me? What's wrong with me? I'm going to fix myself. And then maybe that would provoke them to change. But you know what you do? You blame. You point the finger. So things don't get better. So you know what you do? You're going to get that new car. You get that new home. Then you're going to get into a new relationship. But you're taking the old you and you're putting it in these new things, so you destroy it, because you never change you. So if you want your life to change, you got to change you first. You got to change you. Stop looking for a change in others. People are always looking for an external change. Why? They don't want to look inside, because why? Inside is dark. Inside, you got to face your own inner demons. Inside, you got to face the Satan of self. And that's often painful. People don't want to look at themselves. So me, I was messed up. You know what I mean? So I worked, I read, I studied, until my weakness was transformed into a strength. And just as I rose from the slums, from the ghetto, whatever you want to call it, from a neighborhood where I hear gunfire going off all night. I could be walking down the street seeing cats getting stabbed up. Just as I arose from those slums and these bums, so can you. You can do the same thing. The only thing, the only distinction between you and I and anyone else is the work ethic. And you got to be willing to suffer. See, the thing is, most people don't want to suffer. See, because of cognitive dissonance, most people, when they experience anything that's painful, you want to get rid of it. Think about why marriages end. Marriages don't end primarily because they can't work. They end because people don't like feeling uncomfortable. But if you really want to be successful in life, in marriage, you got to get accustomed to feeling uncomfortable, because there's sometimes that you're going to disagree. And so remember this, watch this, watch this. Everyone will hurt you. You know what I mean? Even if it's not done intentionally, everyone in your life will hurt you. So you got to discern who is worth suffering for, because everyone's going to hurt you at some point. It may not even be intentional. Someone's going to say something to you that you love, and it's going to hurt you, going to hurt your feelings by the way that you react to it, unless you actually learn to control your emotions. But you must be able to discern, is this man or this woman worth suffering for? If not, then shalom, have a nice day. But if so, you better eat that and learn to deal with that from a different realm. So you got to be willing to suffer. But the problem is, most people do not want to be feeling uncomfortable. The problem is, you want to be comfortable, but your comfort zone is your mortal enemy. Watch this. Your comfort zone is your worst enemy. See, check this out, King, Queen. When you live life not taking risks, or not being challenged, or not being taking a risk of being hurt by love, life will send you more and more discomfort, because you want to be comfortable. That's the average person. That's the average person in life. They want to be comfortable. That's average. That's typically what people do. They want to feel comfortable. So life will send you more and more problems, more and more resistance. The more you try to, evade difficulties and struggle, the more life is going to send at you, because that's life. You see, person, damn, what happened to him? He look old as hell. Life happened to him. He couldn't handle it. You see her, damn, what the hell happened to you? She's all smoked out on crystal meth. Life happened to them. They couldn't handle it. See, when you're not strong enough, then you start and you go and look for some sort of external substance to quell your pain, because you were not equipped right up here to deal with the pain. So you went to get some sort of drug or intoxicant to try and use that as a sedative, because you wasn't willing to suffer. You wasn't willing to undergo the pain. So life keeps sending you more and more discomfort, more and more discomfort, more and more struggles, more and more issues, and more problems and resistance. So life will keep handing you difficulties and struggles and other issues until you are willing to suffer. There's no one that actually became great unless they was actually willing to suffer, to undergo difficulties, to fall down and to get back up. Fall down and to get back up. You see, young king, because people were so wrapped into them being comfortable and them not experiencing pain. So instead of just falling down and getting back up and pushing harder, they want to feel comfortable. They don't want to strive for progress. They don't want to face the falls. They don't want to move beyond the suffering and keep going, keep pushing through the suffering, keep pushing through the struggling. So they remain in pain for their entire life. Because if you suffer a little, at the end of that suffering, on the other side of that pain is a success and it's the things that you want. But you have to endure the pain. You're not here on this planet. Check this out, King. And if you're listening to me and you're fat, I want you to be offended, because that's the only way you're gonna change. Right now, you probably listen to me. Oh yeah, Tyler Doc's about to come on. Yeah, let me go and get some popcorn. Get me a soda. If you're down south, you're probably saying a soda pop. Again, get me a damn slice of pizza, because you think I'm an entertainer. I'm not here as a damn, I'm not no damn entertainer. I'm here to try and help you improve your life, because I suffered and I'm trying to like use my pain and experiences so you could actually say, damn, I'm going through the same thing right now. So the Most High has actually raised me up to show you how to deal with those things that I've already experienced. But you got to be willing to suffer. You're not here on this planet to sit on your fat ass, and you're fat, on the sofa and watch Netflix marathon and, you know, keep drinking a beer, eating pizza, and eating that damn Intimate, and you're fat. But you just keep overindulging in food, gluttony. You're here to grow. You're supposed to be leaving a legacy. That's what life is all about. And if you don't make yourself uncomfortable and trying to lose your weight, trying to lose all that fat, then life, if you don't make yourself try and be better in your relationship, in your marriage, trying to be more successful on your job, or whether it's actually creating your own business, if you're an entrepreneur, then life will give you plenty of reasons to be uncomfortable. You have to make yourself uncomfortable. No one has actually ever become great just feeling comfortable all of the time. So you have one or two options, family. You can commit to constant growth and become master of your own destiny, or you can hand over the damn keys and let life kick you in the ass and handle you by default. And you're going to just be average and, at worst, a damn failure. See, one path leads to success, and you suffer and you hurt for a little while. But after that suffering and hurting, it's just like in the gym. That kind of pain, there's two different kinds of pain. The kind of pain that you experience in the gym, if you're doing it right, is temporary pain. You suffer for that kind of pain, but from that kind of pain comes growth, comes development, comes the body that you want. But the other kind of pain, and you're fat and you're sitting at home and you're eating on a damn jelly donut and you're watching LeBron James and you're wishing that you was like him. You're wishing that you was like him. But what your fat ass is not seeing, and you're definitely, you're fat. You know, I want you to understand, I keep emphasizing this, you're fat. You're fat. And your fat ass sitting on, you imagine that you was him. But what you don't see is you don't see all of the hours that he's running around the damn basketball court. All of the times that he's shooting that jump shot to try and perfect it. You don't see that. You don't see when these people with the magnificent bodies, like the sports models and all of that, you don't see them getting up 5 a.m. in the morning, just working out in the gym, getting a burn, while your fat ass is walking out, picking up a damn newspaper and your damn robe and looking at him, hating on him because he just came back from a 5-mile run and you're about to just draw off to work, drinking on some damn coffee. And you can't think of the last time you went to the gym. And when you do go to the gym, you're jaw-jabbing. You're just jaw-jabbing. So you hate him for it. You hate him for it. And it turns out he might be a nice guy like me. And you hate yourself because you hate him because he's a nice guy. And he's devoted to his craft. And you hate him for it. But you really hate yourself. So you got to get your mind right, king. Get your mind right, queen. So you have to be willing to suffer. One path leads to success. If you suffer a little, it gives you a lifetime of pride. But if you don't want to be uncomfortable, if you don't want to suffer, you will have a lifetime of suffering for the remainder of your life, the remainder of your life, because you're just going to sit around and talk about what you could have done. You're going to talk about what you should have done. George Abbott. And people don't want to hear that. People don't want to hear about what you used to do or what you could have done, you should have. That's never happened. So it's your choice. Do you think that Bill Gates started Microsoft by being comfortable? Do you think that Steve Jobs started Apple and all these damn iPhones by being comfortable? No. He had to study. He had to research. He had to suffer. He had to sacrifice his time. So why are you putting so much damn time, you know, sitting on your fat ass, eating a damn cheeseburger, eating McDonald's, eating Intimates, watching basketball games, football games, a Netflix marathon? Why are you going, you know, out smoking damn blunts, drinking Hennessy, drinking beer, malt liquor, whatever, as soon as your friends call you to go? Why are you doing it? Why are you not investing your time wisely? Why are you running out every time your friends ask you to come out? They're average losers. To me, being average is a loser. You've got to be willing to face your adversities, and you have got to be willing to be uncomfortable. You've got to be willing to face rejection. You've got to be willing to fall down and get back up. Fall down and get back up. That's what you got to be willing to do, king, queen. You've got to be willing to face these things because that is what's necessary for success and for you to be different and better than average. So it's not possible that, you know, you said, watch this. How many of you, watch this, before I get into this lore stuff, my spirit just had to give this message to you because a lot of people know. So is it not possible that the life that you're living right now, how many of you actually ever said this? If I knew then what I know now, my life would be very different. How many of you ever said that? If I knew then what I know now, then my life would have been different. My life would have been so much better. How many of you have said that? Be honest. If I knew then what I know now, things would be so much better. How many of you said that? So is it not possible if you said that? Watch this. Is it not possible that now that your life that you're living right now, the life that you're living right now, if you lived it differently, if you develop an awareness that you do not currently have, would your life not be better? Is it not possible that your life would be better if you develop an awareness that you currently do not have? Yes, it would. Come on, 10. So the Most High has raised me up. It's not by chance that you're watching this video. It's not coincidental. Things don't happen like that. The Most High put you in my path so I could give you this message. You may not like the messenger, but accept the message. I don't care if you don't like me. You can hate me. I don't care about you hating me, but I'm giving you love. So receive the message. Even if you don't like the messenger, hear the message. The words that I speak is truth. So Yahweh raised me up so that you can develop an awareness that you don't currently have, to do the things that you have not done, to go to places where you've never been. So I'm telling you, family, it's waiting for you, but it's outside of your comfort zone. You got to stop being comfortable. You got to stop being comfortable, and you got to go and get the things that you want. You can accomplish those things. You can accomplish those things that you want, but you got to do the work now. See, life collects payment, but life does not have any friggin' payment plan. Life doesn't have no payment plan. Life will not allow you to get away with experiencing things that you have not invested time and struggle into to earn. So to get your gift, you must sacrifice. You must sacrifice. Sacrifice must be paid up front in full. That's the only way that life deals you a reward. So such is the only way that you will achieve what you want in life. So I therefore strongly suggest that you start working out now. If you're fat, and you're fat, if you listen to this message, if you listen to this message and you're fat, I suggest you start working out now. I suggest that right now, if you listen to me and you're sitting on your fat ass with a damn soda in your hand, you shouldn't be drinking soda anyways, man. If you just stop drinking soda for a week, you automatically going to lose 10 pounds without working out. So I'm talking about, you know, an excessive soda drinker that drinks it every day. If you just stop drinking that for a week, you're going to lose 10 pounds right away. So I suggest that you stop eating the bad foods, stop eating the pizza, and you start eating the healthy foods. But it has to start ahead. There's no secret. You see all this bull crap online about people like they want a quick fix, get abs in 5 minutes, 5 minute abs. That's all bull crap, man. That's all bull crap. It's selling you a dream. If you want an awesome body, you have to suffer. You have to transform that body. You have to break down the muscle tissue to transform that fat into muscle. And that's not done in 5 minutes. That has to be done by pushing yourself beyond your comfort zone. You have to stop being comfortable. Therefore, I strongly suggest that you start working out right now. That you get your fat ass to the gym and stop eating bad foods right now. If your relationship, your marriage is about to go through a divorce, I suggest that you stop arguing right now. Stop putting your spouse down right now and start practicing kindness and compassion instead of jealousy and envy. And you study harder. You push yourself through the struggle. You try harder. Stop procrastinating and start doing these things wholeheartedly now and watch your life change. I promise you this, that when you stop putting things off and you start pushing yourself to be discomfort, to be uncomfortable, and you push yourself out of your comfort zone, your peers will start to take notice. Your enemies will start to take notice. Your friends will start to take notice, and life will start to take notice. Then life and your dreams will begin to support your dreams. But you have to got to start taking a step now. And you got to take the first step. And I promise you, it's all waiting for you, but it's all outside of your comfort zone. You're not going to get this by being comfortable. You got to make yourself uncomfortable. Do you understand? So what are you waiting for? It's all waiting for you outside of your comfort zone. Stop being comfortable and do it now. So with that being said, just needed to put that message out there. Hopefully it uplifts your spirit. It might have cut some of you if you're fat, but hey, so be it. It's going to help you change your life. You need to hear this. So next thing I wanted to talk about is the structure of courts. And should the case be filed in a state or a federal court? Many people don't know this. So I was talking yesterday, if you watched the video yesterday, if you didn't watch it yesterday, go back and watch the video yesterday about, you know, the five elements of court. And when I was talking about how to deal with debt collectors and so on and so forth. If you haven't watched that video, go and watch it on this channel right here or on the other channel, Deprogram Enlightenment. If you're on Facebook, you can watch it on Facebook as well. So that being said, there are two court systems in the United States. Corporation that you think is a country, it's a corporation, 10 square mile radius in Washington, D.C. But nevertheless, there are two court systems in the United States, the state court and the federal court. You say, oh, whoopee damn do, Tyler, I know that already. Sway. So the state court typically hears matters relating to like civil, criminal, domestic, such as divorce and child custody. Many of you are familiar with that. Probably some of you are going through that right now. Probate and property in accordance with the laws, or should I say the colorable laws, of each state. Each state has its own colorable laws. Now, matters typically heard by federal courts involve things like violation of federal laws, admiralty and maritime matters, United States patent, like land patents or trademarks, and copyright matters, and so on and so forth, bankruptcy proceedings, proceedings against ambassadors and things of that nature, and consuls and ministers and so on and so forth. All of that would actually be dealt with in federal court. So these matters usually fall into two main categories. The first category is federal question cases, cases which arise under the Constitution, laws or treaties of the United States. And again, the United States that you think they're talking about, they're not talking about that. The United States they're talking about is the District of Columbia. It is not talking about the 50 states united. Now, states, there are two diversity cases. There's civil matters arising between parties who are citizens, which makes you a slave, according to the 14th Amendment, of different states, and the amount of controversies exceeds $75,000. So for the issue to be in a federal court, there has to be adversity cases, such as two people being from a different state that will make it a federal issue, because some person is going to be saying, hey, I want it in my state. The other person is going to say, have it in my state. So the federal court takes it over. And the issue has to exceed $75,000. If it doesn't exceed that, it's heard in the state court, typically. That's probably valuable information for many of you, because many of you probably didn't know that. Now, I want you to remember, I was talking about yesterday the five required elements of a lawsuit. So before, understand this, before filing, for educational purposes only, before filing a case in federal court, you must decide if the court has jurisdiction. You can't just file it. Jurisdiction, again, is the authority given to a court to hear and decide a specific case. So the United States Supreme Court is given its authority by Article 3 of the Constitution. You've actually heard me say over the years, take it to an Article 3 court. That's what I'm talking about. Whenever I say an Article 3 court, I'm talking about a federal court. Understand that. According to Article 3 of the Constitution. Go and read it for yourself. So there are many instances when the United States Supreme Court might review a judgment rendered by a state court, but those instances are rare. So, occurring only when there has been a final judgment or decree of the highest court of the state in which a decision could have actually involving a substantial federal question. So then the federal court may examine it. Do you understand? Do you understand? Now, normally the United States Supreme Court reviews judgments rendered by the United States Courts of Appeals. Understand that. So of which there are actually 13 federal judicial circuit courts of appeals. Do you understand? So the United States Supreme Court has original jurisdiction over matters involving treason and presidential impeachment. So if you want Donald Trump out, hey, you guys might want to start looking towards the Supreme Court, but I don't think it's going to happen because a lot of people seem to love Donald Duck Trump. So now, the stuff that I'm about to go over right now are all of the federal courts which are established and given their authority by acts of Congress under the constitutional authority. Now, the United States Courts of Appeals, the Courts of Appeals for the District of Columbia and for the First through the 11th Circuit hears appeals from the Federal District Court, Bankruptcy Court, Tax Court. They also review some decisions of various federal administrative agencies in these particular courts. Now, the United States Courts of Appeals for the Federal Circuit hears appeals from federal decisions of the federal district courts for civil actions arising under any act of Congress relating to patents, plant variety protections, copyrights, trademarks, including claims of unfair competition when joined with substantial or related claims dealing with patents, copyrights, etc., as well as final decisions of the district courts and the United States claim courts where the United States is actually sued as defendant and appeals from decisions of the United States Courts of International Trade and the United States Patents and Trademark Offices, the United States International Trade Commissions relating to unfair important practices, and decisions by the Secretary of Commerce relating to import tariffs, among other things. Now, the United States Courts of Military Appeals, I don't know how many of you are familiar with that, United States Courts of Military Appeals. This court hears appeals from court-martials decisions. You're in the military, you should be familiar with this if you got court-martial, which is not a good thing. There is no further appeal from this court. So if you get a court-martial and you go through the United States Court of Military Appeals, there's no court after that. You're following a total different jurisdiction. Any of you ever served in the military, you know what I'm talking about. Uniform Code of Military Justice. You fall under that particular system of law, a color of law, should I say. The United States Claim Court, this United States Claim Court, hears certain kinds of actions against the United States government. Uh-oh. Got a claim? Follow the United States Claim Court. So except those involved in torts. I went over what a tort was last night. So if you didn't watch the video from last night, again, go back and check that video out. So they handle this except those involved in tort claims under the Federal Tort Claim Act. So these cases may be appealed to the United States Courts of Appeal for the Federal Circuit. So and I'm going to tell you, man, most of you are not familiar with this, even though some of you may pretend you are. You're going to have to go back and listen to this video several times to get this information. Because part of the problem, when many of you guys contact me, you're filing your case in the wrong court. And I told you I would move the court. And then when I tell you, for educational purposes only, I'm not giving you advice. I just facilitate information and right knowledge. When I told you to move the court, you don't know how to move the court. So next thing I wanted to talk about was United States, the tax court of the United States. That's what they call it. Now, this court hears cases concerning federal tax laws. Its decisions may be appealed to United States Courts of Appeal. So if you've been to a tax court, something of that nature, you don't like the decision, you were supposed to take that into the United States Courts of Appeals. Do you understand? How many of you actually did that? Or how many of you just bowed out, punked out, and accepted whatever decision they actually gave you? Like Wesley Snipes and Lauryn Hill. So United States Court of International Trade. You heard me mention that. This court hears cases concerning federal tariff laws. Its decisions may be appealed to the United States Courts of Appeals. For federal circuit, the United States Bankruptcy Courts. How many of you been into that? Some of you filed bankruptcy. How many of you actually ever been into the United States Bankruptcy Courts? See, these courts hear all matters pertaining to bankruptcy and financial reorganization. Their decisions actually may be appealed to the United States District Court and, in some cases, the appropriate United States Courts of Appeal. So you see, most of these courts, if you want to file an appeal, you have to go into the right court. So you got to know what you're doing. You can't, oh, I'm going to go and just file, listen to this. It doesn't work like that. This is why many of your paperwork is getting kicked out. You got to know which court to go into. And don't call me. Don't bombard my phone, as because I'm telling you right now, for educational purposes only. Telling you for free. All you got to do is listen to this video several times. You'll know which court you're supposed to be filing your claims in. Now, the United States District Court, these courts trial, they try both criminal and civil actions and sits as admiralty court. They may also review decisions of the federal administrative agencies. There is at least one United States District Court in each state. There's at least one in each state. Their decisions may be appealed to the appropriate United States Courts of Appeal, but you got to be in the right one. Now, I want you to take note, the United States District Court for the District of Idaho is located in the Ninth Circuit of the United States Courts of Appeal. To those of you that's actually in Idaho, do you understand why Idaho? Because I was actually looking at something in that state and helping someone, so that's why I mentioned in Idaho. So the federal district courts have both civil and criminal jurisdiction. Now, they have original jurisdiction in the following types of actions. Hear me well. They have original jurisdiction when it comes to civil actions arising under the Constitution, under laws or treaties of the United States, which is actually federal question cases. Actions where the matter is actually in controversy exceeds the sum of $75,000 exclusive entrance and cost and is actually between citizens of different states and citizens of a state and foreign states or citizens or subjects thereof or citizens of different states in which foreign states or citizens of subjects thereof or additional parties. They refer to these as diversity cases. So if you're in one state and someone else in another state cross you, that's going to be considered a diversity case, and that case would actually be heard in a federal court, not in a state court. Do you understand? And they can't deny you from actually going into a federal court. So all criminal offenses against the law of the United States is heard in this court. Admiralty, maritime, prize cases are all heard in this court. Bankruptcy matters and proceedings are heard in this court. Actions of interpleader involving money or property of value of more than 500 or more claimed by citizens of different states are actually heard in this court. Now, keep in mind, that has to be a citizen of a different state. Actions to enforce, enjoin, to set aside, annul, or suspend in whole or part any order of interstate commerce is actually heard in this court. Actions or proceedings arising from any act of Congress regulating commerce or protecting trade and commerce against restraints and monopolies are actually heard in this court. Speaking of commerce, you know, pretty much every friggin' thing is actually commercial, so you know what it is. So, I mean, everything's commercial. So the next thing, and there's a lot more stuff that's actually heard in that court. I'm not going to, like, really go over all of those and just badge you on. Next thing I wanted to talk to you about, how much time I got done 43 minutes already. Next thing I want to talk to you about is rules and procedures for filing a case in district court. Now, that the other way that many of you screw up is you don't know the civil rules and procedures of the court that you're going into, or you don't know the federal rules and procedures of the court that you're going into. So you file documents to tell the doctor, they ignore my paperwork. Well, did you follow the civil rules and procedures? Did you follow the criminal rules and procedures of the court for them to hear you? Because if they just ignore your paperwork, they're denying you due process of law. And you could have the case dismissed for educational purposes on that premise alone. So it has to be that you're not following the rules and procedures for filing the case in district court. Now, whether you are a party to a lawsuit, a person representing yourself in pro se or in propria persona in a lawsuit, or an attorney representing a party in a lawsuit, you are subject to the rules or procedures for any court in which your case is filed. Do you understand? The attorneys are not excluded from these rules. So the federal courts are governed by the federal rules of civil procedures. Understand that. And the federal rules of criminal procedures, as well as other rules or procedures regarding other arenas, such as evidence, appeals, etc., etc. So no matter what documents or procedures you are involved with, you must follow the practical rule or rules that govern the matter. Do you understand? If you don't follow that, the black robe is going to ignore your paperwork. And that's what's been happening to many of you. And you just don't get it. Oh, tell the doc, they ignore my paperwork. Well, did you follow the rules and procedures of that particular court? So in the United States District Court, all procedures are governed not only by federal rules of procedure, they are actually governed by many courts. Keep this in mind, like Idaho, they're also governed by local rules of civil procedures. So you got to check the court that you're going in and see if there's a local rules and civil procedures also. So the numbering system of the local rules coincides with the numbering system of the federal rules for easy reference. So let me just go over some of these rules and procedures so you get an understanding, a comprehension of what you should actually be doing. Now, keep in mind, you're going to have to check the rules and procedures for your particular state. You got to check them for your state. So the rules, the procedures found in the local rules, for instance, general format of pleadings, that's rule 5.1. Proof of service, rule 5.2. Copies of orders and envelopes, rule 5.4. Non-filing of discovery pleadings, rule 5.5. Motion practice, rule 7.1. And so on and so forth. There's so many rules there. I'm not going to go over them all, but this is what you must follow to ensure that when you're filing something in court, that your documents is actually not being ignored simply because you're not following the rules and procedures. You got to make sure that you're following the rules and procedures and be aware that this is not, I didn't go over the complete local rules and procedures for any state. You would need to make yourself familiar with the local rules and procedures and the civil rules and procedures or federal rules and procedures of the court that you're going into. So, and you also have timelines. You have timelines that you must go by. You got to keep all of this in mind. Some of you try and go the day before and you try and submit something into a record and they don't understand it. I mean, they don't accept it because you don't comprehend that you have specific timelines that you must go by. Now, there's something called a civil cover sheet. The document must accompany the complaint or the claim summons before filing can occur. That's the civil rules and procedures. So if you don't have the cover sheet, they're not going to accept it. So are you following these procedures, or are you just going in and trying to give them something? You wondering why they're not accepting it? Because he know that you don't know what you're doing. And I usually won't put this kind of information out here like this. I usually teach this at a seminar because I'm giving you some really valuable information here. Now, the complaint, the second thing. So you set out the party, you set out the complaint to parties, the controversy, and the governing law, the allegations, the statements of facts, and the demand for relief. You gotta put this out there. Then the next thing would be summons. Summons is typically issued by a clerk at the time of the filing of the complaint. Now, you could actually pay to have a sheriff serve that summons or a public service person. So it's generally issued by a clerk at the time when you file a complaint or claim. The summons is actually served on the defendant with a copy of the complaint or the claim. A waiver of service of summons can actually be served on the defendant with a copy of the complaint or claim. The summons informs the defendant refer to them as respondent, that they must answer the allegations in the claim or the complaint, or judgment will be entered in favor of the plaintiff. So in other words, if you just simply acquiesce, ignore it, judgment is entered against you. Which part of that don't you get? So you can't just ignore this stuff. I'm just not going to show up. You can't ignore it, man. You're going to get a judgment against you. It's going to hit your credit report. You understand? So motions and proposed orders would be the next thing that happens. Now, to seek an order from the court on some particular matters during, a case, either party may bring the motion. Now, again, I file all of my motions under the heading of an affidavit. So then after the motions, response to motions or the affidavits. So the other party is entitled to respond to the motion. The reason that I file all of my motions under the heading of an affidavit, because the maximum law states an unanswered affidavit stands as the truth. So if I file an affidavit, they don't answer. Guess what? I win by default. They didn't answer it. He that leaves the battlefield first is the one that loses. Then you have what is known as a proof of service requirement. So whenever a document is filed with the court, there must be a proof of service certificate included. Otherwise, how you know they got served? Which actually certifies that a copy of the document was actually sent to the other person. How many of you are doing this? If you're not doing this, you're not following the rules and procedures. And this is why the black robe is not taking your documents. Do you understand? So let's clear this up once and for all. So then, what's next is the copies of the pleadings. So when motions and stipulations are filed, you are actually required to include copies of the proposed order and stamp address envelopes for each of the parties to be served. So you got to make sure that each side is served. You know, I'm going to tell you something, man. I was sitting in the court one day and the black robe, the judge kicked the case out because the person that was actually bringing the complaint or the claim didn't get each party served. So the judge kicked it out. So you got to make sure that all parties are actually served, because everyone has to actually have the opportunity to be able to offer their response, their answer. Do you understand? So then after that, you have what is known as the discovery. So initial disclosures or disclosures of expert testimonies is what your discoveries consist of. Notices of depositions, interrogations, requests for documents, for admissions, and so on and so forth. All of this is actually essentially part of the discovery. Do you understand? So this is what you need to know if you really want to be effective when filing your documents in court. And so The forms, essentially, let's say if you're going in impropria persona, you should, if you're going in impropria persona, you should be knowing what forms that you got to sign. You're calling yourself a Moor. You claim to know the law. You should already know what forms you have to take in. But I have people that Moors contacting me, and they don't. So what are you teaching these people in these lodges, in these temples? So nevertheless, let's say if you're going in pro se, what you need the civil cover sheet. You'll need the summons in a civil action. You'll need the subpoena in a civil action. So you should be writing these things down, right? Hey, because I'm about to bring this to an end if I get you these three things here. So the fourth thing, I'm kind of like just going back over the things that I just gave you. You should know the scheduling conference form, which is the litigation plans instructions. See, when a case is assigned to the Article 3 judge, you should know scheduling conference form, the litigation plan instructions, notice of availability of the magistrate or the judge to exercise the civil jurisdiction and appeal option. You should know that the waiver of service should be there. Notice of lawsuit request for waiver of service summons should be there. Notice of assignment to the magistrate judge, the general order number, typically 98, scheduling conference forms, litigation plan instructions, same thing as a schedule conference form, notice of a lawsuit request for waiver of service or summon. These are all the forms you're going to need if you're going pro se. Waiver of service summons, instructions for filing a complaint under the Civil Rights Act. 2 U.S.C. Section 1983. That was 2 U.S.C. Section 3, Salakia Section 1983. And the last thing you would need if you're filing, if you're going in pro se, is a certificate of service by mail. A certificate of service by mail. Now, let's say, for instance, for educational purposes, that you're in prison. And I'm not into helping prisoners. If you committed a crime, if you raped someone, if you robbed someone, if you stole from someone, if you injured another party, this is not for you. You deserve to be there. You know, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, life for life. But if you're in prison unjustly because these corrupt bureaucrats just wanted to look at you as another number and to make currency offer, this is for you. So let's say, for instance, you are a prisoner and you are innocent for educational purposes. So one of the things that you would need if you're filing there is an application to proceed in formal propagus supporting documentations in order. The other thing is instructions for filing a complaint by a prisoner under the Civil Rights Act 42 U.S.C. 1983. The other thing you would need is petition under 28 U.S.C. Section 2255 for writ of habeas corpus by a person in federal custody. And the last thing that you would need if you are a prisoner is a petition under 28 U.S.C. Section 225 for writ of habeas corpus by a person in a state custody, if you're in a state prison. Do you understand? So those are the things that you will need if you effectively want to stand as a man or as a woman in court and not get your paperwork ignored like has happened to so many of you, because essentially you really don't know what you're doing. You've actually just been using guesswork. Why? Because you don't want to put the time in. You don't want to study. You just want a quick fix. You want to file secure party creditor paperwork, but you don't want to take the time to learn. You don't want to study. You don't want to research. You want to go online and you want to listen to Joe Blow and he sell you some BS story like Angel Poppy or one of them other people online that's misleading you. And then when you want real help, you come to me and you want me to work a damn miracle. But I can't do it. You have to study to show that self-approved. So if you study and do the research, then you're going to be all right. But if you don't, woe is you. Woe is you. So, I mean, what you going to do? I'm going to tell you something else before I leave. They're not going to just let you do this easily. They're going to challenge you to make sure you know what your legend that you know. And if they, and the judge always knows, he's dealt with so many people like this. He knows whether or not you know what you're proclaiming, that pretend that you know. And if you don't know it, they're going to figure it out. And they're going to pick your ass apart like Mr. Potato Head if you don't know it. So you got to know this, man. And the only way to know it is study, research, study, research. You have to struggle. You have to suffer. You have to read. Watching videos is good, but you got to read and check it out. Everything that I said to you in this video, I don't want you to believe anything. I dare you to go and check it out for yourself. Go and check it out. Don't trust me. Don't trust nobody. Only you can save yourself. You're the self-savior, man. Can't nobody else save you. You understand what I'm saying? I'm just a guy. I'm just a facilitator. I'm not even a teacher. I'm a facilitator. That means I facilitate right knowledge. So you take from what I present that's for you and everything else, then you just let it slide off of your shoulder. But don't hate. Don't hate. Participate. Don't get on the bandwagon, because then you go into debtor mode. And debtors always lose. Debtors either get thrown in a box, you know, pay a fine, or they just sit around and complain about what they should have done, what they could have done, but it's never done. Shoulda and coulda is not a reality. It's something that could have actually been a possibility, but in reality, it actually has no substance. The only reality is right now. You want to see what's real? You turn around right now and you look in the mirror. Stop talking about what you're going to do tomorrow and do it right now, because what you do right now is going to determine your tomorrow. Your only reality is right now. Whatever you want to do, you got to start doing it right now, this instance. Because you keep putting it off and putting it off and putting it off, you're going to end up with a lot of empty yesterdays. And then you're going to spend the rest of your damn life wishing that you had done what you said you was going to do. Then you get mad with me because I'm doing what I said I was going to do, and you hate me for it. And since I'm such a nice guy, you hate your fucking self because you're a loser. You're a loser. You hating on another man because you could have done the same thing. The only thing that actually differentiates me from you is dedication, devotion, and I'm willing to suffer. I'm willing to suffer a little bit to make myself better. Because after all of that suffering, on the other side of suffering is the things that I want. And on the other side of your suffering are the things that you want. But guess what? You're not courageous enough to face that. You listen to those freaking losers that tells you, yeah, man, when opportunity comes knocking on the door, you better take it. Well, you fat fuck, opportunity don't come knocking on the door. You got to tear the fucking door down and you go and take opportunity. Opportunity doesn't come knocking on the door. Ain't no one's going to give you anything. Nothing in this life comes free. You could ask anyone in New York that, man. You ain't got your rent. You getting out. They're going to throw your stuff out on a curb and film nothing. Opportunity don't come knocking on the door. That's in a perfect world. This world is not perfect. This world is wicked. So get your mind right, king. Get your mind right, queen. So with that, I'm going to bring this to an end. Thank everybody for listening. Like the video. Share the video. It's going to help some people out. Going to change their lives. Might even change your life if you listen to it 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 times and share it with someone else, a family member. And if they don't want to have it, they don't want to hear it, then hey, shalom, have a nice day. But some of the things that were stated in this video will change your life, because guess what? They change my life. So I'm speaking from experience. I don't just talk. I'm not just Georgia. The stuff that I say, I speak from passion. I speak from the heart. I speak from experience, or I'm speaking from someone that I know personally and they've been through it. So everything is real. So that's the one thing you got to give me, is that I'm real. So forget all the people, all the damn keyboard warriors, damn keyboard arrangers sitting behind the damn keyboard talking about what you're going to do to Tiles of Doubt. Well, fuck you, man. I'm gonna do nothing to me, man. So I mean, you can go ahead and keep on hating, throwing around hate, but you're still a loser. You're still a loser. So, you know, thanks for the hate, because you motivated me. Without your hate, I wouldn't have had that inspiration, because that hate, it energized me to like push a little bit harder, because he's hating. And I want to be better than you, because me being better than you, I know it's going to make you suffer more. So you keep right on hating, because I'm using your energy. I take that negative energy and I transform it into something positive, because nothing released in the universe is wasted. Even negative energy, we can convert that into something positive, and that's what I do. So keep on hating, and I'm going to keep waving at you two fingers. Peace. Tell the doctors out. Shalom.